Keeping track of cash is simple. You have $5, you give your friend 2, now you have $3 because 5 minus 2 equals 3. How do you know? Well, you can physically count that the cash remaining is equal to $3. And you know your friend has $2 because he can do the same. But how does our friend know that the cash he just received is actually legit? And by legit, I mean it was legally minted and not forged in my basement. Well, my friend would have to physically examine the bills he received to ensure legitimacy, but unfortunately for him, there is no way of stopping me from forging bills if I wanted to. I would just have to make the fake money look convincing enough and not try to pass off some monopoly money. But cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin are different. You can't physically count how many Bitcoins you have left, or even physically examine them for legitimacy. So how is it even possible to keep records of cryptocurrency transactions, and what stops someone from giving themselves Bitcoin if it's all digital anyways? Well, that's where cryptography, the blockchain, and some pretty interesting math come into play to track Bitcoin transactions and ensure each Bitcoin is legit and nobody is creating malicious transactions. Since Bitcoin transactions are more or less public knowledge, sending secret messages is less important than verifying the information, which still uses the principles of cryptography. Cryptography is essentially the process of passing messages between parties so that any outsiders are unable to understand what the message is. It can involve using complex math and algorithms to ensure data confidentiality, authenticity, integrity, and non-repudiation. The blockchain, for those that don't know, is essentially a growing ledger for recording cryptocurrency transactions. Each block is made of a hash function based on the previous block, a timestamp, and the actual transaction data. The hash function is what we're most concerned with. The hash function acts as a digital signature, verifying that the data about the transaction wasn't forged. It's almost like handwriting. As an illustration, imagine every picture of the Mona Lisa had Da Vinci's signature on it. You could find out which Mona Lisa is the original by having every artist that claims to have painted the Mona Lisa to sign their name. Now, just compare all the artist's signatures to Da Vinci's actual signature, and you'll find the authentic Mona Lisa. Now, there are certain requirements a hash has to meet to be considered secure. First of all, it has to be deterministic, meaning the same message encodes to get the same hash. Secondly, it has to be one way, so it's infeasible to invert or reverse. Thirdly, it has to be quick to compute. And fourthly, it has to be infeasible to find two messages with the same hash. And lastly, the fifth characteristic of a hash, it has to give way to the avalanche effect, which is essentially where if you change the original message only slightly, the new hash will be so different that a pattern is undetectable. Keep in mind, not all hash functions are built the same. One of the best ways to leave digital signatures that humans have discovered so far is by using elliptical curve cryptography. This allows one to have a 256-bit private key just as secure as a 3072-bit private key using RSA protocols. Equal security at a fraction of the computing power. So, how does this work? Well, an elliptic curve is a graph that satisfies the equation y squared equals x cubed plus ax plus b, where 4a cubed plus 27b squared does not equal 0. This parameter just keeps things from getting ridiculously complicated. They are symmetric about the x-axis, they operate over finite fields in cryptographic settings, and they also have a very interesting quality of having an intuitive way of adding two points on the line. Here is the graph of y squared equals x cubed plus 7, the curve that Bitcoin is based on. Here's how you add two points. You draw a line between them, and wherever that line intercepts the curve at the third point, you take that third point and reflect it across the x-axis. Graphically, it looks like this. Here is the curve made by the equation y squared equals x cubed plus 7. If we set the point negative 1.1642.328 equal to p and the point 1.773 negative 3.546 equal to g, then the line through them leads to the point 3.391, negative 6.783, which we will set equal to k. However, in order to get the graphic sum of these points, we need to take this point and reflect it across the x-axis, which we represent with the green line. This leads us to the point 3.391, 6.783, which we set equal to r. Notice how the y-coordinate is now positive. This is our sum, so p plus g equals r, which we found graphically using k. However, algebraically, this is only true for elliptic curves due to some things that only operate within finite fields that these curves operate on. In fact, if you try to add p and g normally, you'll notice that the answer makes zero sense from the beginning. Elliptic curves operate on a principle called point addition, and this is drastically different from normal addition. For the sake of brevity, we'll simply say that the process involves finding the equation of the line that passes through P and G using point-slope form and substituting that equation for y in the original equation of the form y squared equals x cubed plus ax plus b. And finally, finding the third root of the equation. Keep in mind the other two roots are P and G. Now, what happens if we add P to itself? We'll use a different point for P this time. Using the same curve, we set P equal to negative 1.13, 2.357. This point was chosen at random. In order to add this point to itself, we use the tangent line to find the other point the line intersects on the graph. Think of the tangent line as the line that connects a point with itself. We find that the line tangent to P intersects the curve at 2.92, 5.647. Reflecting this across the x-axis, we get 2.92, negative 5.647. This reflected point is our sum in this case. So P plus P equals 2.92, negative 5.647, which is also equal to 2 times P. You can do this as much as you want, finding the tangent line to a point and reflecting its second intercept on the curve and reflecting it to get a new point. Wash, rinse, repeat to get multiples of your original point on the graph. Now, let's say you're given a random point on the curve. You use this to calculate a random multiple of P. This is a private key. Since there are an ungodly amount of possible starting points, and the amount of times that you multiply P is random, your signature is totally infeasible to replicate. But let's say that someone has managed to guess the exact same number. How do you prove that this is your signature? Well, it's kind of a complicated procedure, but basically all you need to do is provide three pieces of evidence. The multiple of P that you ended up with, the final calculation you made to get that multiple, since it takes many billions of calculations, the final and most relevant one will suffice, and what that multiple was encoded into. This is called a zero-knowledge proof. It works on a similar principle as the Diffie-Hellman protocol. So, despite giving the person asking for verification of your key, you're not actually giving them any of your personal information, because you use that private key to encode everything you didn't want to make public. And as we've already seen, it's borderline impossible to use the private key to find out any of that information. So that's how Bitcoin does it. Through utilization of cryptography, blockchain technology, and some pretty interesting math, Bitcoin is able to keep records of all transactions that occur and ensure that all Bitcoin being transacted is legit. And furthermore, the math ensures that nobody can go back and change a transaction, so you know that all transactions are final and your funds are not going to just randomly disappear. The best part is, you don't have to trust anyone on the network, as cryptography ensures your private keys are never exposed and that no one can use a public key to calculate your private key. So next time you check your Bitcoin wallet, you can be assured your funds are still there, because now you understand the math behind Bitcoin.